He came into the midst of his people, or in the midst of the people. Always great things happen. People got healed and devils got cast out. But the Bible says that where two or three today are gathered together in his name, there he was going to be right in the midst of them. So I still think God's going to do some great things here today. And the Bible says also, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Everybody take a big breath, say, that breath that you just breathed, you couldn't even take that breath without the Spirit of God. It's in him that we live and move and have our being. And so I'm thankful today for the Spirit of God and that he's given me breath. Because when I do this, that's giving glory to God. And I'm going to do some old songs, just about three songs here. And I'm going to get out of the way, but I'm going to do some old school stuff. Now, y'all sing, my God is real. He's real in my soul. I love that. I love that. Where's that? I see you. Yeah. That was great. And then the other one was, it was something else. It kind of had a nice groove. So good. So good to me. So, you know, Pastor liked the slow songs. I like those with that groove going. But anyway, all right, I'm going to shut up. This is an old song. It says, some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away. Y'all go ahead and play that track. Goes like this. I'll fly away. All right. I told you these were old songs. You got that? Y'all started clapping, made me feel like I was growing up in the good old days. And we used to do songs like that, and people would shout all over the place. Y'all remember that? So that can still happen today. God has not changed. But all right, let's see here. Let's grab. I told you I was going to do three songs, so let me just grab. Okay. I did this yesterday. I've had to play this a bunch of times for Jake. This is his favorite song. So, Jake Robinson, I'm so glad to be here with this brother. He does a great job on YouTube, doesn't he? And he does such a good job with barbecue until I took a shower this morning and sprayed down with cologne, and I think I still smell like barbecue from yesterday. But he's just a good brother. It's good to be here. And thank you, Jake, and thank you, Pastor, for having me. And this is an old song. Now, when you start this track back there, when you start it, just let it go all the way to the end, because the song talks about a train that's bound for glory. And Pastor already said today that Jesus said upon this rock, or upon this revelation of who he is, he was the mighty God in Christ. And the Bible says that upon this rock or this revelation, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. Said, if God be for me, who can be against me? I like that. Said, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. So if you get on this train, it's going right on out of here, one way, straight up. So I'm going to try to play it like my old grandpappy used to play it. Go ahead, roll it. Let's make sure we're on the right train track here. Yeah, okay, here we go. Here we go. Papa used to play it like this. We'll be right back. Now you see, the train's really, it's not going to slow down though, but it's making one last stop in 2015, and I believe the coming of the Lord is very soon. And when that happens, that whistle's going to blow, and this train is going to move straight on up out of here. All the way to glory. Amen. Amen. Man, I had an old pastor when I was growing up. He used to sing all kinds of verses to that song. He would sing, this train, well, you know how it goes. This train is bound for glory. This train is bound for glory. This train. And then it's, this train is bound for glory. If you ride, you got to be holy. Well, he would make up verses. This train don't care no jokers. You know, and this train don't care no gamblers. This train don't care. And he'd get carried away up there sometimes. He'd be making up stuff. And by the time he got through, man, it wasn't nobody left on the train. It wouldn't care. Oh, but anyway, all right, one last tune here. And we did this last night, and I love this song. Because without the grace of God, none of us would be here. It's His grace that saves us. And this song is my favorite hymn of the church. It just says, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. Now, I know y'all probably, that train song was moving. Might have been hard to sing on it, but you can sing on this. I'm going to point to you. And y'all help me sing. This will be my last song here. And y'all worship the Lord with me. Go ahead. Amazing Grace. Not the easiest song to play when you're out of breath from playing the train. Thank you. Are you thankful for his grace? Praise God. God bless you. God bless you, Pastor. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Brother Todd. Go ahead.
Let's praise God. Let's clap our hands to God. Amen.
I believe he's played that before. Yeah, no, that's exactly what I was thinking. What am I going to do now? But anyhow, I wonder, he has a CD table out there. I want to encourage you, look, $15. I encourage every single one of you to pick up one of his CDs because here's the deal. Okay, Todd came all the way from North Carolina for a very marginal amount. And I need you to buy a bunch of his CDs to help him over the top. Amen. So everybody pick up a CD. I'm getting one. And it's going to be jamming on the way home today. Because that's some good stuff. I don't care who you are. That's some good stuff right there. And I just wonder if you could get Jake to work your product table and if you could do the blood that Jesus shed for me as our altar call. Yes, sir. The blood that could never lose its power, because I just believe God's going to move. And I'm going to try to be brief, but I tell you what, I ain't going to apologize for giving that brother 10 minutes. Because that's the best 10 minutes y'all have had in a long time. Amen. Just a few really quick announcements. Work day this Wednesday here at the campus, 5 o'clock. I already told you Ashley will be moving on next week. And then the pavilion, the project is stalled. I don't think I need to say why. It has done nothing but rain. Okay, so as soon as we get a few dry days together, we'll be able to do the outer ring of concrete, and we'll be able to finish out that fire pit, and we will be in there, baby. But anyways, this Wednesday, we're going to try to go ahead and rough in the sidewalk, lay some 2x4s, do some digging. I'm not positive if the rails will be done by Wednesday, but we're working toward that, and we got some rails. We got a really good deal on the rails. Brother Andrew is going to build the rails for us, and that's going to save us several $100s. We're super thankful for that. But let's pray. Father, I pray for your word. I pray for the hearers of the word, and I pray in Jesus' name, Lord, that whatever I say, I'd say it quickly. In Jesus' name. Amen. That's the best rise I've gotten out of y'all in a long time. I almost heard a shout in there. Today's message is the church's finest hour. I want y'all to say that with me. Say, the church's finest hour. And how can this be the church's finest hour? Well, first of all, if you'll turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. We're going to read verse 33, and it says this. If you haven't had a chance to get there, then it'll be up on the screen. It's very simple. It says, but seek first his kingdom, being Jesus, and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. And this is when Jesus was talking about worrying and how we tend to worry as a people. And he said, therefore, I tell you, don't be anxious about your life, nor about your body and what you put on. Is not life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air that neither toil nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than these? He says, and who of you by being anxious will add a single cubit into your life? He says, but seek first. He says, the pagans seek after all these things. What shall I wear? What shall I put on? He says, Solomon, in all his splendor, was not dressed like the lilies of the field, which are here today and gone tomorrow. He says, how much more shall I clothe you and take care of you, O ye of little faith? And look, we've seen our country experience a shaking over the last couple of weeks. We've seen some things get shook up, and I've seen some Christians react like they've lost faith. I've seen some Christians react as if, well, the day is over for the church. But I'm here to tell you, I believe this will be the church's finest hour. However, if I were the devil, this is what I would do to the church. I wouldn't attack Christians right now. I would first distract them with so many issues that they lose sight of the kingdom. I would help them to lose sight of their original purpose by making them feel like they're letting Jesus down if they don't share their feelings on every single social issue that comes up. I would get them to spend so much time focusing on all these different things that's wrong with the world today that they would either have no time or no energy to focus on their mission. No one would listen to them because they sound like a bunch of lunatics. following the example of Chicken Little, constantly shouting, "The sky is falling, the sky is falling, the sky is falling." And that is what the church looks like to the world today. Our reaction has been nothing short of foolish. And I'll be honest, sometimes I get swept up in the issues. Sometimes I get swept up in the stuff and the junk that goes on in the world. But I personally think we as the church have fallen into a very clever trap. The devil has tricked us into believing we are to champion every cause. Amen? When truly, we are to champion only one cause. And his name is Jesus. To build his kingdom. Now, am I advocating we bury our heads in the sand and pretend these issues are not happening? No! What I am saying is there's only one solution to these problems and these issues, and it hasn't changed in over 2,000 years, and his name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of the living God, the only hope of this world. And when we get to the place where we recognize my hope is found in nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, there is nothing else on this planet that can solve our problems. Our shouting, our screaming, our taking on these issues and all these different things are creating nothing but chaos. Folks, don't get caught up in it. God is still 100% and absolutely without question in control. And I think he wants his people to behave as if he is. When you have control of a situation, your behavior is confident. And when I see the church today, I do not see confidence. I see panic. I see despair. I'm going to say this. Last week, the service was ridiculous. I'm serious. It was ridiculous. It was like you all had just caved in. And when I say you all, it's a general statement. But there was a heaviness here that it doesn't belong with God's people. The Bible says, in his presence, there is fullness of joy. And I love it when it says, and the Lord blesses his people and he adds no trouble to it. Your trouble doesn't come from God, folks. If we focus on Jesus, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be taken care of. What if we did that? What if we said, Jesus, I don't care about ISIS. I don't care about the Supreme Court. I don't care about the Congress or the House of Representatives or even the President of the United States. I don't care what they do. I'm going to fix my eyes on you. And I'm going to proclaim your name. Can I tell you, the name of Obama cannot save you. The name of Mitch McConnell certainly cannot save you. Notice I said certainly in front of his name. Certainly cannot save you. There is no man that can save you. It is only so. Why are we calling out these people's names? Why do we keep calling out these people's names as if they can do anything? Why don't we call out that name that can actually do something? And instead of claiming ISIS and all these other things, why don't we just call out the name of Jesus and say, Jesus, only you are the solution to the problems on this planet. Only you can solve the issues of my country. And Lord, instead of posting about the issues on Facebook, I'm going to post about your goodness. What does it say leads men to repentance in the book of Romans? Does it say telling people they're sinners? Does it say telling people where you stand on the issues? It says the goodness of God leads to repentance. So let's be displayers of God's goodness. And you watch your environment change. I will tell you what, if nothing else, it will change your attitude. There are so many Christians today, we have attitude problems and we blame it on the world. I wouldn't have this attitude if Obama would get his act together. He started making some better decisions. And that Supreme Court, I'd have me a better attitude if they'd just quit approving all this stuff I don't approve of. Has nothing to do. Your attitude is because you're just nasty. Fix your attitude and all this other stuff will work itself out because Jesus is coming back to get his church. Amen? And I love that song, There's Coming a Day. When no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, and all is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be, and what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, and when he takes me by the hand and leads me to that promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. What if the world saw that? What if the world saw every time we get something tossed our way, we just worship God? And say, oh, there's coming a day when all this stuff ain't going to bother me no more, so I ain't going to let it bother me right now because I'm looking to my future. Satan, you are defeated. Every agenda that you're pushing in my face is already concluded because I read the end of the book and you lose. Amen? What if that was our battle cry? The name of Jesus. I want to show you a movie clip from Apollo 13, one of the greatest movies in American history. And let me give you some context before they show the clip. If you all know the mission of Apollo 13, basically what happened is they had some malfunctions in the rocket. They were, what did they call the little thing? They were the space capsule or whatever, that thing. They had a malfunction in the thing. Okay, and the funny thing is some duct tape is what fixed it. I told you yesterday, if you can't fix it with duct tape, then you don't need it. Amen. Duct tape and extension cord. If that can't get the job done, then it just can't be fixed. All right. So anyways, it was looking real grim. And it was looking like they were going to lose these boys. And they weren't going to make it back. And they were going to lose pressure. They were going to lose oxygen. And, you know, you lose oxygen in an airplane. You know, they can do a nosedive real quick. You lose oxygen when you're near the moon. Bye-bye. So if you please show that clip.
Copy that.
Is this typhoon still present in the splashdown
here? Yeah.
We got the parachute situation, the heat shield, the angle of trajectory, and the typhoon. There's just so many variables. I'm a little lost.
I know what the problems are, Henry. This could be the worst disaster NASA's ever experienced.
With all due respect, sir, I believe this is going to be our finest hour.
I love the stunned looks on their faces. But there were two things that were said in this clip that I think were critical. The first guy said, I know the issues. What I need is solutions. And there are no solutions. This is going to be the greatest disaster NASA has ever known. And that dude looked at him with all the confidence that he could muster up and said, no, sir, I disagree. All due respect. I believe it's going to be our finest hour. And I believe I've heard that said about the church. All these things that have happened is going to be the greatest disaster this country has ever seen. It's going to be the greatest disaster the church has ever seen. All due respect, I believe this is going to be the church's finest hour. Amen. Let me give you five ways, as quickly as I know how. I usually only have three, so you better pray. Five ways that we can make this the church's finest hour. Number one, value your family. Ephesians 5, 22 through 26, it says, wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, this is my favorite part. Love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with the water. Through the word. Why am I reading that verse? Because it shows that moms and dads, if you will protect your family first by protecting your marriage, that is the greatest. See, Paul says, I'm telling you a profound mystery, but I'm not talking about a husband and wife. I'm talking about Christ and his church. He says that later on in that chapter. You husbands loving your wives with everything you have. And wives, you submitting to your husbands in mutual love with everything that you have is the greatest display of God's love on this planet. It is the greatest example of how Jesus loves his church. So do you want the world to see a different church? Then start by loving your spouses. You start by doing everything you can to honor them and to love them and to cherish them, and you watch some things change. See, we want to holler about gay marriage. We want to get all bent out of joint about gay marriage, and some of us don't even value our own marriages. Some of us don't even work out our own troubles at home. And look, stuff happens. Marriages dissolve, things fall apart, and divorce happens. And sometimes it cannot be avoided. But a lot of times it happens because we just refuse to love each other. You think my wife is a perfect bed of roses to live with 24/7? Look, I'm going to make it out of here safely. I ain't worried. She is a beautiful, ravishing, wonderful woman of God, fantastic cook, fabulous mother, wonderful educator of my children, but sometimes she wakes up and she is not in a good mood. And can I tell you, it is in those moments that I love her most. You know why? It's because it gives me the privilege of recognizing how wonderful she actually is. You know, I think that just sounds silly. But when someone isn't at their best, it makes you appreciate their best. And sometimes my reaction isn't exactly stellar. Sometimes I'm thinking, you want to bring that baby? You know where I'm from. Bring it. Let's go. Right? And she's like, that's what she says. You better pack a sandwich. This is going to take a minute. But I love that woman in good times and in bad, for better or for worse, and richer for poor. And God, there's been a whole lot of poorer than richer, but I am thankful for everything that we have. God's been good to us. Then it goes on in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1 through 4. It says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first command with a promise, that it may go well with you and you may that you may enjoy long life on this earth. Young folk, you want to live a long time? Listen to your mama and your daddy. You hear me? And it says, fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Don't aggravate your kids. Train them. Train them. Can I tell you that your children typically, I say typically because there's always exceptions to the rule, typically will grow up how they're trained. Now look, there are different circumstances and different, I know everybody's got a different personality, and I've watched two children trained by the same parents turn out totally different. But typically speaking, if you train their children, they'll turn out the way you trained them. Amen? Problem is, so many of us, we don't train our children anymore, we let them train us. And then our vehicles become taxi services for our children. Our money becomes the food fund and the whatever fund for our children. And look, I'm not saying if you do those things, bless your children. Amen? Give them a ride already. It's okay. But don't let them run your life. You to mama and you to daddy. Train them. Don't let them train you. Can I tell you that if we would just deal with that issue alone, we would see a massive difference, not only in the church, but in our country. Why does the Supreme Court not value family? Because the Christians don't value family. We work ungodly amount of hours chasing the dollar, only to see it fall through a bag with holes in it, as it says in Haggai. We chase everything except what matters. And folks, what matters is what's going on in your own home. Second thing, besides value your family. Number two, this is going to sound self-serving, and I do not care. Folks, I'm a real person with real feelings. And I do a job that is sometimes very difficult, but always filled with joy. Support your pastor, support your ministers, and support the church board. Do you want to see a difference? Do you want to see a difference in America? Do you want to see a difference in the church? You want to see a church with joy? First of all, love your family. Number two, support the leaders in your church. Listen to what it says in Hebrews 13:17. Now, this is stronger language than I would use because I'm kind of wimpy sometimes. But it says, obey your leaders and submit to their authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give an account. See, that part messes with me because I'm looking at y'all and saying, Lord, I don't want to be accountable for them. It says, obey them so that their work will not be a burden but a joy. For that be no advantage to you. Those are really strong words. But here's the deal, folks. I need your support. Our ministry team needs your support. Our board and our decision makers need your support. We need you praying for us. We need you encouraging us. Now look, I'm not up here to put no wine session for ministers, okay? Ministers in America have it pretty good. ISIS isn't cutting our heads off yet. Ain't nobody really persecuting us to any great degree yet. And most of us have air-conditioned offices. I ain't trying to pretend like we're out there slaving, digging holes and all this other stuff, but what we do is very serious, and what we do is very strenuous because we are carrying the weight of the spiritual warfare of a church. When the devil attacks you, he attacks me. And let me tell you something. When the devil attacks you, he also gets me. Because when he comes after you, I'm standing in front of you saying, hold up. I'm the sheriff around these parts. And you don't get to them unless you come through me. And I've got friends that are willing to help. The ministers of the church and the board that help me carry this burden. They help me carry the fight. I fight for you all every single day by calling out your names before God and by preaching the truth, regardless of whether or not it's popular. I carry your burdens with me daily. The only thing I ask is that you do the same for me. Do the same for me. Carry the burden together. Support me. Support these ministers. Support this board. We are making groundbreaking, difficult decisions in the face of opposition, and we need to know there's some people behind us. I love what it says in Ephesians chapter 4. Start with verse 11. It says, it was he. Who's the he they're talking about here? A couple verses before, it's talking about Jesus. So it says, it was he who gave. Some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers. I didn't call myself. I was called by Jesus to prepare God's people for works of service so the body of Christ may be built up. So what's our job? To prepare you for works of service, to prepare you to do what God's called you to do. And it goes on, it says, until we all reach unity in the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ, then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men, their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, which we'll talk about that in just a minute, we will in all things grow up in him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined together, held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So the job of the ministry leaders here is to support you into maturity. And sometimes maturity is not comfortable. Sometimes we have to say and do things that are uncomfortable. Sometimes we have to implement discipline. Sometimes I get tempted to play the Imperial March whenever I have a meeting in my office. As a matter of fact, I did that a couple days ago messing with somebody. But sometimes that's what it feels like. I mean, you think I enjoy confronting sin? You think I enjoy having somebody just march up in my office and tell them, you know what, you ain't doing right, and if you don't do right, then we're going to have to pull your membership. You think it's fun? You think I'm like, woohoo, I get to discipline somebody again. No, I hate it. I hate it. But that's part of my job, because my job is to help you reach maturity, and you can't reach maturity unless sometimes you're confronted. Can I tell you, we already hear lots of complaints. Already there. We hear complaints from the world. We hear complaints from the church. We already get that. Now, I'm going to say this, and then I'm going to let it sting for a minute. I wonder if the reason the world has no respect for pastors in the church is because they hear Christians complaining and gossiping about them after church at restaurants. Did you hear how long the pastor took this morning? Or do you see that girl's dress? Let me tell you, she looked like a fool up in there, bent over in the altar call. Somebody need to get her a cloth. Y'all do realize there's lost folks there listening, right? And they're losing, not gaining respect for your pastor in the church. Some of you assassinate the church and Christians and pastors with this. Speak positive. There is always negative, folks. There's always negative. There's always things to beat people down with and discourage people with. But speak positive. When you're outside in the world, talk about the positive. Man, there was a harmonica player there. I tell you what, boy, I tore it up this morning. It was so good. We gotta get that fella back. We had a dog. I mean, find the positive and talk about it. Build up your church. Build up your leaders. Love your family. Support your leaders. Third one. See, I'm already three-fifths of the way there. Be faithful to your church. And volunteer. See, the last text I read, it says, from him the whole body joined together by every supporting ligament grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. See, if each part is not doing its work, then the church suffers. And I look and I see faces, and folks, some of you are not involved. You're hurting us. You're hurting the mission. I mean, you look around today, it's pretty obvious. We got a lot of people gone. It's July the 4th weekend, got a lot of people traveling. That's the way it is. But the fact is, it seems to be the excuse every week. And let's just be honest. We got some people that are just not faithful. Now, there's some faithful people that aren't here today. Don't get me wrong. Don't be going, Pastor said you was unfaithful. Okay? But we have some people that just are inconsistent. They're not committed. And what's the word say about that? Go to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23. It says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess. For he who promised is faithful. So he's given us an example. And then it says, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another all the more as you see the day approaching. You know what that tells me? We need to get together more often as times get harder. Can I tell you, folks, times are getting harder. You don't need a degree in rocket science. You don't even need to know how to play a harmonica in order to figure that out. Times are hard today. They're getting harder. We should be getting together more. That doesn't mean we need to have more church services. I'm totally disinterested in dragging y'all here more. What I'd like to see is for us to get together in each other's homes and encourage each other throughout the week. Sunday, Wednesday, I believe that's just pretty darn good. I think we ought to leave it alone. Because if we keep gathering here, well, folks, in case you ain't figured it out, the world ain't exactly gathering in here. We need to go out there. Okay? Go to McDonald's with your brothers and sisters and find places to go. Go into your neighborhoods and get together more often. But we need to be faithful. We need to be faithful. Every time the doors open in church, unless you have got something just pressing that you just can't avoid, your honey should be in here. And you may say, well, Pastor, it's awful judgmental. The fact is, I'm not doing this for my own health. I'm doing this for our own good. We do two things. Sunday morning gathering, where we get up and we celebrate Jesus. Wednesday night, where we promote education. We want to disciple you. One thing I always tell someone who says, Pastor, I'm struggling with my faith. I always say, get involved in the life of the church. You cannot get involved in the life of a church by showing up at 10:30 and then burning it out of here once the service is over and we don't see you again for another week. We have too many that are attending church, but they're not involved in the life of the church. Now look, take that for what it's worth. Do whatever you want to with it. And you know, if you don't listen, guess what? I'm still going to love you. Not because it's my job, because I genuinely do. But we cannot have the full benefits of maturity that the church offers unless we are involved in its life. See, the church is not an organization. It's an organism. It's living. And when we're involved in its life, we get life from it. We get encouragement from it. We get growth from it. We get transformation from it. And I just happen to believe we got something for everybody. Are you struggling with addiction? We got something for you on Wednesday nights. Are you feeling lonely? We got something for you on Wednesday nights. Do you like to be challenged and pushed and educated? Just stay in the sanctuary. We got something for you on Wednesday nights. You got children? We got something for you on Wednesday nights. We got an Impact and a Ranger program that is second to none. Largest outpost in the state of Kentucky, may I add. Phenomenal leaders, dedicated men and women. We have nursery. We have something for your youth and your teenagers. An incredible youth ministry that we invest heavily into. So be faithful to your church, but not just be faithful. How else do you get involved in the life of the church? Volunteer. There is something that happens in you when you give your service to God's church. See, Jesus said, on this rock, on this revelation, I love the way you said that, of who he is, I will build my church. He didn't say, I'm going to build your church. He didn't say, I'm going to build Pastor Tim's church. He didn't even say, I'm going to build Lakeside. He said, I'm going to build my church. See, the church is God's idea. So if it's God's idea, it's a good one. Just like marriage was God's idea. We cannot redefine God's idea. If it's God's idea, he gets to give it the definition. What is the purpose of the church? To build each other up, to encourage one another in love. And all the more as you see that day approaching. So how can this be the church's finest hour? Get involved in the life of your church family. Not just in the events we promote and that we do, but do life together. Fourth, now I'm about to get real unpopular, if I ain't already. Give your tithes and your offerings. Leviticus 27:30 says, a tithe of everything from the land, whether grain or soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to him. And you may say, well, I ain't got no grain, fruit, or trees. What it's talking about is increase. And I wish I had time to teach you on this, but you're just going to have to wait till September. So now y'all know when to take vacation. I'm preaching on tithing and giving in September. Be prepared. But in the meantime, I just want to give you a little snippet. I know why I got two claps, because this ain't no popular subject. But call this segment a sermon, whatever you want. But if the church is going to be the beacon of light, what is our purpose? To be salt and light in the world, in the world. How can we do that if we can't pay our bills? My mother said something, who is here today, that I thought was profound. She said, failure to tithe is a vote to close the church. So unless you are wanting the church to close, you got to tithe. And it belongs to God. Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's, the fullness therein, and all the people and everything in it. So if he wanted, he could ask you for 100%. But he asks for 10. Can I tell you that the summer months are amongst the most difficult that the church faces? Because when families move away, we lose that income. And also, money, God's money is taken on vacation. Please, can I tell you, when I take my vacation in September, I am going to enjoy myself. I'm going to have fun. And I'm going to spend every dime we saved. All of it. I ain't leaving nothing. If we got 20 bucks left, we're going to do something with that 20 bucks, because I am spending my vacation money without guilt, because I'm a tither. Because I give God his part. I give to missions. I give to every little cause that I can, so I can spend my money freely without guilt. I'm going to blow every dime, because I'm going to have the time of my life while I'm on the beach with my toes up in the air, laying on my towel because I hate the sand. I don't know how I get talking to going to the beach every year, because I hate the beach. All right, people be posting your beach page. I can't wait to go. Have your fun. I'd rather be up on the balcony looking down. Have I made it clear I do not like the beach? But I love spending time with my family. So here's my encouragement to you. Have a blast when you go on vacation. Do everything you've budgeted without guilt or shame. And don't forget, there is still a local mission going on while your toes are up at the beach that needs to be funded. And when you're spending God's money on your vacation, the mission of the church suffers during the summer. Happens every year. Our income, every summer. We're in the thick of it right now. That's just the way it is. So let me ask you a question. How is this going to be the church's finest hour? We've got to be generous. Can I tell you that if you'll give God his part first, he'll take care of your victim. Remember, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added onto you. And look, if I'm stepping on your toes this morning, I'm not sorry. Because I'm trying to help you. Do you want victory in your life? If you can't get victory over your wallet, you can't get victory over anything. Because here's the deal. We'll throw $5 at a kid knocking on our front door just to get rid of him. The church asked for $5 and we want to get upset. That's all church wants is my money. Well, the gas station wants your money. McDonald's wants your money. Burger King wants your money. Walmart works wants your money. And we'll wait in line to spend it. I'm going to give you one piece of advice. Everyone suffers from financial difficulties at times. Can I get an amen? But sometimes you are suffering from financial difficulties because you are thieves. Because you are stealing God's part and he is withholding his hand and he cannot bless you. You think this is easy to say? It's getting easier. Because I'm starting to realize how important it is. If you're stealing from God, you cannot be blessed financially, period. So if you haven't, look, I'm not going to say go back and check your records and try to get caught up. I'm just saying start today. If you haven't, go chase the treasurer down. Go chase somebody down and say, I want to start my tithe today. If you chase the treasurer down, here's the funny thing. She already knows because she counts the money. Boy, that just got uncomfortable, didn't it? Here's the good news. I don't know because I don't check. Have no idea. But you can't count the money and not know. Just kind of the way it works. If I get some music. And just play a little bit and I'm going to ask you if you'll get prepared. Last thing. I did pretty good. Focus on the mission. Let me review real quickly. Number one, value your family. How can this be the church's finest hour? Value your family. Number two, support your pastors, ministers, and the board. Number three, be faithful to your church and volunteer. Number four, give your tithes and your offerings. And number five, focus on the mission. What do I see from Christians today? Confederate flags, rainbow flags, ISIS flags, state rights, civil rights, racisms, and everything under the sun seems to be dominating our conversation. You wouldn't believe how you feel about the rebel flag, brother. Man, I don't care. Only thing I care about is Jesus. Take it off the General League. Take it off the TV stations. Do whatever you... I don't care. I do not care. Put it on the back of your pickup truck and drive it down the road. I don't care. Take it off of federal buildings. I don't care. Do it. Do whatever you got to do to get peace in your life. I just want to focus on Jesus. I just want to focus on Jesus. And if you care deeply about it, forgive me for not caring. I know it represents a symbol of hate for some. I know it represents a symbol of racism for some. For others, say, oh, it's just a rebel cause or whatever. I don't care. I care deeply about people getting hurt. And I would never in my lifetime fly a rebel flag because I know it hurts some of my friends. But why are we letting these issues dominate our conversation and our focus? It just further divides us. It rips us apart from the inside. See, that's Satan's plan. If I was the devil, I would get Christians so wrapped up in flags and issues. I get so aggravated watching Christians back and forth on Facebook. One in support and one against. Get a grip, folks. Let's focus on Jesus. What is the mission? Matthew 22, verse 36 through 40. Somebody said, what can I do to inherit eternal life? Or what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus said this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And the second one is like it. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second one is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commands. What if I just did that? I'm going to love God with everything I have, and I'm going to love my neighbor as myself, because that fulfills all the law. How do you feel about a rebel flag? I love Jesus. What do you think about the rainbow flag? I love Jesus. Mess with some people's heads. I only care about one thing, and that's Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's the only thing that's going to save. Rebel flag can't save me. The U.S. flag cannot save me. Amen? Rainbow flags, and you name any kind of flag, cannot save me. There's only one name that can save me, and that is the name of Jesus. And that's what I'm going to proclaim every time you try to bring opposition into my life, every time you try to divide us. I've already told you all how I feel about racism. I don't want to have to keep re-clarifying my position because somebody keeps asking. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Him. Another part of the mission. Jesus said in Matthew 28:18, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given unto me. Now therefore go and make disciples of every nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the age. I want to encourage you to do three things. Love God, love others, and share Jesus. Don't get caught up in the issues. Don't get caught up in the junk. Don't let the Supreme Court dictate your conversation. Let the Word of God dictate your conversation. You let what thus saith the Lord dictate your conversation. And when somebody tries to come in bringing division, asking how you feel about this issue, you tell them, I feel like Jesus feels. Whatever He says, that's what I say, because in Him is found my hope. I love the Lord, my God, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind. And I love you, brother. I don't care what your position is. Oh! What if we just love each other regardless of the issues? I'm trying to quit, folks. But I feel like I'm doing pretty good today. John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. It says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world may be saved through Him. The primary mission Jesus sent us was a mission of sharing His love. I've said this several times and I will say it again. Truth without love appears as hate. Whenever you are sharing the truth with somebody, you better make sure that you're sharing it in love. And number two, never tell your friend they're going to hell without tears in your eyes. Let them see your compassion. Let them see that you truly and genuinely care about them. People do not care what you know. They want to know that you care. People will not believe you when you say you love them while you're screaming how wrong they are. I'm going to say this in closing. I don't think the world has any trouble understanding where we stand on the issues. I think the world has trouble understanding that we actually do love them. Wouldn't you all agree? Even when we're angry, we love them. Let's love them first. And then they'll invite us to discuss the issues with them. I honestly think the world has given us a clue how to reach them. What is the world talking about right now? Love. Love wins. Love this. Well, see, we know what love is. You know that old Foreigner song? I want to know what love is. I already know it's Jesus. I'm going to express Him through my life. I don't care if a homosexual couple comes to me and says, how do you feel about gay marriage? I'm going to say, I love Jesus and I love you. And if you'll let Him come into your heart, He'll give you the answers you desire. I'm not saying avoid the issues. I'm just saying don't get trapped in them. The church cannot be limited to what it's against. Just be clear. I am against racism. I am against homosexual marriage. But what am I for? I'm for restoration. I am for hope. The Bible says three things there are: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. This can be the church's finest hour. Love your own family, support your pastors, board, and ministers. Be faithful to your church and volunteer. Give your tithes and your offerings. Focus on the mission. And last, 2 Chronicles 7:14. I'm about to turn Brother Todd loose. If my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves, seek my face, and pray, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. In addition to all this, folks, it's a real good idea to pray. Can I get you to stand? If y'all will get Brother Todd queued up, I'm going to ask y'all to join me up front. Let's just have a moment of worship. Let's do just what we were encouraged to do. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Please don't forget to pick up a CD afterwards. Jesus, we love you. one of the reasons I wanted him to close the service with that song is because he shreds it. But number two is because what an incredible truth. The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary, it's the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. Shine upon you and give you peace. May you be blessed in the city. May you be blessed in the country. May the fruit of your womb be blessed even to the third generation. May all your hands do be caused to prosper because of your relationship with Jesus. I bless you in Jesus' name. God bless you. Hug a few necks. And the brother found me on key. Just walked up and said, burn. I hear Elizabethtown calling you. I see a move in your future in Jesus' name. Ha ha ha.